call, starting from my right with Ryan and...
Ryan Kenny.
George Mendoza.
Gennaro Riccio.
Philip Frederoli.
Jonathan Sproul.
Toni Gilardi. Dan Devlin, Talia Farrow.
Steven Passacantilli.
David Marks.
Bill Lane.
John Pregmon.
So I want to welcome, there's a couple new members tonight. So John Pregmon is a new member and a new council member, Toni Gilardi. And Riccio, I want to welcome them to the Neighborhood Council. And I also want to just announce that we have new elected officers for this term. And Bill Lane is going to be the secretary. Jonathan Sproul is the vice president. And I'm the new president for this coming year. So we had elections for the meeting, and those are the elected officers. And for Matt Conti, he's going to be filming the meeting. And if anyone is here from the media or the press, if you want to identify yourself quickly. Does anyone have any issues with Matt taping? I don't. All right, take it. So, I know I was the president last year. I'm a little off right now. So, report from the Office of Neighborhood Services. If Nicole Leo was here, I don't think she is. Oh, meeting protocol. See?
The meeting will be conducted according to parliamentary rules. The president will have the final word on the conduct of the meeting and will cast a vote only in the event the rest of the council reaches a tie. The president will recognize the speaker to make their presentation or statement, and then he will permit the council to ask questions. He will then open the floor to questions from the audience, and each audience member should introduce themselves by name and street address. No person will speak until they have been recognized by the president. The president will have the discretion over the duration of the question period. He will then entertain motions and seconds from the council, whose majority vote will be final.
If Nicole Leo has showed up since Jonathan wrote the protocol, but I don't think she has. I can report for Councilor Martinez's office. I know we've had some noise issues in the neighborhood, and in the public safety meetings have been well attended. And we are in the process of filing a nuisance ordinance. I believe it's going to be called a nuisance ordinance. And the language in that ordinance is going basically to pertain to, it's going to give the city a little more authority in terms of holding landlords more accountable. So we've done some research and we looked into what they do in the town of Brookline. And what they do on Brookline is they define the term gathering, and that's what we're going to do as well, which is two or more persons. And what they do is when the police are called to a particular address or a particular gathering, they, on the first offense, find the individuals participating in that gathering. And then the second offense and subsequent offenses, they find the individuals and the landlords. So the only thing we haven't really determined yet is what the fines will be. Fines can only be a maximum of $300. That's by state law. So I think what we're looking at is maybe fining the individuals $100, and then on the second offense, $300 per individual, $300 landlords. But that's not, that hasn't been hammered out yet, but that's in the process of being done. I know some people have been asking a lot of questions about the new nuisance ordinance that I spoke about in the April public safety meeting. So that's really all we have from the council's office. We have some committee reports. Resident Parking and Traffic Committee is Ryan Kenny's department, so I'm gonna turn it over to Ryan.
Nothing new from the last meeting. Still waiting on the list of streets from Jim Mansfield, and again, as soon as that is given to us, I'll have it posted on our website.
What did you say? What?
The list of streets that will be exempt from the two-hour visitor parking for residents. As soon as we have that list, I'll have that posted.
So, next committee is public safety, and I can, Dave Marks usually attends those. He wasn't able last Thursday. I don't have the statistics from Sergeant Lima, but I can tell you that Carolyn Conway, or Carolyn, I forget.
McNeil.
McNeil, she stuck around for the neighborhood watch, and Brian Brandt is the resident that has been kind of spearheading that neighborhood watch. So I'm going to be honest with you, I didn't stay till the end. I was only there to announce what we're doing with the nuisance ordinance, and there were still some concerns with residents for parties on rooftops and roof decks and late night activity. So Captain Lee, there were some issues with some residents who didn't feel that the 11 to 4, I think they said a couple months ago that they were going to put a police detail on Hanover Street from 11 to 4 in the morning. Some people said that they didn't think that the last few weekends they were seeing the police presence that they had the last few months. So Captain Lee assured us that he'd, I think it was Thursday, Friday, Saturday, he was going to have...
From 11 to 3.
From 11 to 3. He was going to have a beat cop on Hanover Street. He said two, I believe. Two cops. So we can,
That includes the Suffolk County having...
And that includes Suffolk University having the loud party car. I'm not sure if Suffolk still has the loud party car during... Do they? During
yes.
the... Yeah, so Suffolk and Rich Grealish, they drive around with the Boston Police Department in the loud party car as well, so...
Is that going to change during the summer months? Or?
Yes.
It will change? It will reduce?
Steve?
Yes.
I was at the meeting also. The main concern that that I observed, aside from my concerns, as a resident, not a member of the board, a lot of other people coming over with the same complaints: loud parties, objects being thrown off roofs, people urinating off of roofs, I've witnessed the same situation, and I have witnessed very little police presence. We do get a lot of lip service, but we doesn't seem that we have the appropriate police presence. And unfortunately, I experienced it again this past weekend. I was walking one of my employees home. She lives at the end of North Street. And there were people urinating off 283 North Street, the top floor apartment. And it was like you were walking around New Orleans. And there was absolutely no police presence. It was about the same time that the Four Winds had closed down, so there was a lot of people on the street. And you had guys screaming off a fire stairs, standing on a fire stairs, but that's not dangerous enough, urinating on the ongoing pedestrian traffic. I get an order, but I made a note of the address. In the morning, I called the police station. I called 911 first. They told me I had to talk to the police station. I talked to the police station. They told me to call 911. Okay? So, when I talked to the person at the police station, I told him to call 911. I said, "Listen, this is George from Monica's. I live in the North End." "Oh, George, I know you. I'm officer so-and-so." And he said, "Can you please make an order and have the captain and Sergeant Lehman know that there's an issue at this address, this and that, I think. But I think we have a long road ahead of us. We're not going to experience huge changes. The only way that you come to, some results with this is if we had police presence in the neighborhood, officers walking the beat. There's main drags, there's actual locations, and if the police was here to witness the acts, because after they come, they'll tell you if they don't witness the act themselves, there's nothing they can do about it. So it's your word against the other person's word. So I think that I advised everybody to show up to the meetings and keep on voicing your opinion, because that's the only way we're going to get the city, the police department, to make the right decisions for us, the community.
I'd like to supplement Stephen and George's comments briefly with just some statistics. In the last 30 days, in the period ending June 7th, which was last Thursday, there were two robberies, one break-in, three auto thefts, and three larcenies. Now, if you compare that to last year, during that same period, there were 13 larcenies, and this year, during the same period, three. Compared to the same period last year, 14 break-ins last year, this year, one. A total of 16 loud party calls were made in the month of May. And there will be more information disseminated probably within the next month, maybe give or take, regarding the formation of an online communication forum regarding the Neighborhood Watch Initiative that they just kicked off after last Thursday's public safety meeting.
Steve, I have a question.
Sure.
Regarding what George's comment was about actually identifying an address where there was a loud party and urination off the roof deck and whatnot. When the noise ordinance is in place and their fines put in place, will the landlords be fined as well?
The landlords will be fined on the second offense. So 406 Andover Street, where I live, if I have a party, first time the police come, I don't know my problem. I don't know. So I'm not the landlord. I'm just a resident. I have a party. Police come. They cite me a ticket. Second time they come, they cite me a ticket and they cite the landlord a ticket. But the police will notify the landlord after the first offense. So it's not just going to be like they're going to get this ticket in the mail that there was a party and it was the second party. The first time the police show up to that residency, they will send a letter to the landlord and they will cite the individuals. And if they're students, the university will get notified as well. I'll have it more next meeting. I hope to have in writing what exactly it's going to do. Okay?
Stephen, on public safety, Kyle just told me that the scheduled date for public safety has to be changed. Is this an election in here on that Thursday?
Yes, there is.
So somebody needs to tell Lima or the captain
cool.
to change the date.
I got you.
Okay?
Yep. And then we have one more committee, which is the Greenway, which Donna used to chair, and Bill Lane is going to take over temporarily for Donna. Do we have anything?
There's no report tonight, but I will note that the Greenway board is represented by the Director of Development tonight. You want to stand and introduce yourself?
Sure. Hi, everyone. I'm Jody Woolen. I also am a Northam resident for the past 7 years.
She'll be working with me and the council each month to report to you what's going on with the Greenway. Thank you very much for being here. Appreciate
it. Thank you.
That.
Can I add two comments?
Of course.
Would that be all right?
Sure.
I just wanted to let everyone know that we have installed a lot more skateboard deterrents throughout the parks. And so that's good news. I know that's been a bit of an issue, as well as the fountains are now on, which is wonderful. And I have brochures for our summer season that anyone would like to see a list of our special events and activities.
On that point, before we finish, thank you very much, Jody. I was in the Arena Park the other day and was very gratified to see a group of skateboarders skate up, look around, and then say, well, I'm out of here, and they left because the deterrents apparently are very visible. They just kind of shrugged and said, well, let's move on. They went up toward up the hill. So they were headed toward the other parts of the Greenway probably, but it's great to see that the skateboarders don't feel welcome in the new Armenian Heritage Park, which, by the way, if you haven't gone, is a spectacular place where everybody uses that maze. I've never seen anybody go through without at least playing a little bit on the maze. I've seen Armenians there really kind of worshiping their heritage. It's a very moving experience. I really encourage you to go. Awesome.
So I guess we can move on with the agenda. First on the agenda, if you don't have an agenda, they're right up at the top of this table over here. It's 216 Hanover Street. If anyone's here from the Improv Asylum and they want to step up to that table right there and they've applied to the licensing board to add cordials to the existing malt and wine license. So they have a beer and wine now. They just want to add cordials. And if you guys wish to say anything to the community or to the council, why you want to add the cordials and what the improper assignment is, I think everyone knows.
Sure. My name is Stacey Princey. I'm the Director of Operations for Improv Asylum. This is Pablo Rojas, who's our general manager. The two owners who are usually at these meetings, Chet Harding and Norm Modelette, had a previous commitment to a corporate client tonight off-site, so we couldn't be here. Send their apologies. We do have an existing beer and wine license. We're applying for a cordial license. We employ over 50 personnel, and we have a 200-seat theater under the CDS in the old European building, where we do improv and sketch comedy shows Tuesday through Sunday night. And a lot of our corporate clients, you know, when they come in for events, they're just standard for events that they're expecting that we're not currently able to offer them with just beer and wine. And having a cordial license would enable us to provide that standard for them, as well as bring in additional revenue, which would help us to continue to pay our current employees well and keep our ticket prices low. Our ticket prices, we haven't raised them in quite some time, and we're pretty cheap form of entertainment for people, especially in the current economy. We've been able to stay steady with our business because we feel because of our ticket prices, that's a large part. So that enables people to keep coming and enjoying the entertainment that they found with us. And that in turn would help us to continue to be able to do stuff for the community. We currently do a ton of stuff. We've been open for 14 years, and since almost day one, we've been doing stuff for NEMPAC and North End Against Drugs. And having some additional revenue would help us to be able to do that for free and not have to defray costs in another way.
Does anyone from the council have any questions? What we do is we take questions from the council first, and then we open up to the public. Bill?
I don't really have a question, but I do want to remind everybody tonight and the council that this business has been an extraordinary supporter of a lot of causes and groups in the community. NEMPAC has enjoyed their hospitality for many years. They've really gone above and beyond, providing personnel as well as facility, and being very patient with how we've had to use that facility for a number of days at NEMPAC. And I know that also NEAD, North End Against Drugs, I've gone to their events there, and they've always been, they've brought some of their professional, their whole professional cast, plus their technicians and everybody else, plus all their ushers. And at, I think, no cost to the organization or very little cost. It's been extraordinarily generous on their part. So I support them as a business owner, and I, of course, I would I intend to vote for the to approve the application as well.
John?
So you've been in operation for 14 years, you said? Have you had a beer and wine license for all 14 of those years? Have you had any, like, formal issues with the police in terms of people being too intoxicated or any, like, rumbles or anything?
No, I mean, I can speak to that. We have very strict policies on our alcohol service. All our bartenders are serve safe, including management. It's a requirement of the position, and we maintain a very strict adherence to the ABC, like, regulations of two drinks per person at a time. Very similar to, like, Fenway rules, where we don't overserve, and we're constantly watching. And our staff, like ushers, we have a very systematic way of, like, approaching and dealing with, like, situations, so we can diffuse them if there's any issues at all. But that hasn't come up because of our stringent controls at the bar.
And also, for just to continue, for our shows, if you haven't been there, a typical show is an hour and a half with an intermission partway through. So, we open like 40 minutes prior to showtime. So customers come in, they get their drink, they go into the theater. It's theater style seating. We don't have drink service during the show. And then there's an intermission where they can come back out and get more drinks and then go back in. And like Pablo said, at intermission, we need to look up people off. So just because you come out twice doesn't mean you're being served twice. But it's not like you're just getting ongoing stuff. And usually once the show's over, people kind of clear out and come let the next show come in. It's not a bar atmosphere where people, hang out after.
Yeah, so buckets, right? Bucket beers. How would you do cordials with the, obviously you have a limited amount of time to serve drinks, and how would you do that?
Well, simply maintaining, like, with a two-drink minimum per person, like, with the, Massachusetts law, like, we maintain based on whatever the ounces are for, like, the drink. So, like, if it'll be one wine and then one cordial drink, say, like, a sangria, like, that'll just be two drinks per person or, one, but we wouldn't exceed that on any level. So we do that based on the measurements that have been, set.
The buckets of beer are usually just people that, two people coming up that we're going to get two beers each anyway. We just serve it in a bucket, same buck.
Yeah, it's the same thing with our pitchers. Our requirement is when people come up, we said you have to have two valid IDs and two people present. So it's not like, oh, I'm going to buy it for my friend inside the theater. We require the other person to be there so that we can gauge whether or not intoxication levels or things like that.
Would you serve cordial drinks and pitchers? Would you serve cordial drinks and pitchers?
We haven't really, other than, like, say, a sangria, if we do that, but, that's mostly, like, juice mixed in with, like, ice and stuff like that, so, like, dilutions. It wouldn't be anything bigger than that.
So, okay.
Yeah. So,
do you serve coffee?
Currently,
we don't.
No, but that is actually something we've discussed.
We've done it on and off before because we don't serve food. We currently don't serve food because we only serve beer and wine. So because we're not serving pastries or anything else, and because we're not a restaurant or a bar where people are coming in, hanging out, they're usually just going in for the show. They're allowed to bring it in, but we don't have currently.
Because some people use the cordial license to, there's all these funky vodkas and stuff now. So you guys plan to expand your alcohol well, it's just beer and wine now, but is the plan to kind of do those sweet martinis and, you said sangria, but what's the plan? So for the cordials, what will you have? You're going to have Sambuca and Frangelico, or are you going to have, like, the Sky Vodka's cherry flavor, lemon flavor?
I mean, initially we were thinking the sangria. We were just kind of thinking small because we only have a short window to get everybody through, so we weren't looking to, you know, come in because we have a cordial license, have a full, you know, looking bar, just to add a couple drinks to what we currently have. And for when we have corporate clients, then maybe, you know, so you can come in as a company and have a private show where you might rent our lounge and have it catered prior to or something like that. So if you're coming in, you might request, oh, we wanted to have this, this, and this, so we would be able to, with our license, have those three things, but it's not something that we would necessarily start on again.
Steve? Have a question. Are you aware of the fact that cordials only involve certain things? You know, you can, you know,
yeah,
and there's certain guidelines that you have to follow, and mixing is one of them. You know, there's also the guidelines. So you, you know, we would advise you to get the proper information on that.
Anyone else on the council have any questions? Does anyone have?
Yeah, what's the hours of operation?
Hours of operation during the week, we were open till 1 a.m. With alcohol service ending at 12:30, and then on Friday, I think Fridays and Saturdays, alcohol service until 1:30, everyone up by 2.
That's on the weekends?
Correct.
Is that what your license says now?
Yes. So the weekend is actually 2. The license is 2.
Yes.
That's what our license is. That's not what our actual hours are.
No, I wasn't questioning how you use it. I was just asking.
Yeah.
Well, that's 7 days a week.
Yes, but we're primarily open for just 6 nights a week, and you know, Mondays are just reserved for corporate events or special functions.
What's the capacity of the theater? So how many people are in there at one particular time? What's the what's the capacity of the venue?
The theater where the show is seats 200. Our capacity is 260. So you know, we do have someone at the door with a ticket, like a tally counter. So
I can't believe I've never been in there. I apologize.
Yeah.
Missing a good show, Steven.
Yeah.
Does anyone have a question? Anyone care to ask a question about anything? Does
can
anyone
I add one thing to that?
Sure, you can add one.
Just because I feel like it might be a concern for the neighborhood that we're located, you know, at the far end of Hanover Street, and while we bring a ton of customers to the neighborhood for up to all the restaurants, because we don't have a working kitchen, we don't serve food, so you know, we always recommend that they come in. We actually have dinner packages with the 5 or 6 restaurants around us, so we're bringing people into the neighborhood who typically eat and then come to our show. But once their show is over, then they're heading out the opposite end, you know, because they're back to the garages or the tea or whatever. So we're not letting 200 people out of our theater dispersed into the neighborhood being, you know, part of that drunken rowdy crowd that you guys meet.
Does anyone want to?
I'll make a motion to support the request for actually a malt and wine.
So
cordial and malt, okay.
So there's a motion on the floor.
On the floor.
For 216 Hanover Street to add cordials to the existing malt and wine license. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Anyone second?
Second.
There's a second. All in favor of 216 Hanover Street adding cordials to their existing malt and wine license. All in favor?
10-0.
What is that, 11?
No, you don't vote. It should be 10-0. 10-0.
Congratulations.
Marie, how do you think?
That's right, Marie left.
Thank you very much.
Can I get you an agent? I have some papers. I watched you spell it, so I don't do it wrong.
You're all set. I'll send a letter. I'll send a letter to the licensing board on your behalf from the neighborhood council. Okay. Stay on the street. Yeah. Dave Cochini has filed an application with the zoning board of appeals for zoning relief to change the legal occupancy of the building from 4 residential units in a retail store to 3 residential units in a fitness center. The renovation includes conversion of the basement. Is that correct?
Correct.
Take it away, brother.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President, members of the board. Congratulations to those new members to the board, and good to see a nice diverse group. My name is Daniel Toscano, attorney at law. Law office address at 62B Commercial Walk East, Boston, Mass. 02110. I represent Dave Cochini in his request to change the legal occupancy of 133 Salem Street. Dave Cochini is to my immediate right. To my in the middle is Mike Bradley. Far right is Neil Thompson. Neil Thompson, and they're going to be the owners. Are they the owners and operators of CrossFit? I'm not sure if you remember this particular petition about a year ago. Dave came before the neighborhood to change the occupancy. Dave bought the old Sheldon's building, and at the current legal occupancy at the time he bought it was just a retail space, which covered three floors of space for retail. Dave changed it with the idea that we keep some retail space on the first floor, one bedroom residential apartment on the first floor, two residential apartments on the second floor, and on the third and fourth floor would be an owner-occupied duplex where Dave and his family would live with his wife and his two children. What we'd like to do is eliminate the one-bedroom apartment on the first floor and expand the retail space and change it to a fitness center and utilize the basement. Under the old plans, we weren't utilizing the basement, so under the new plans with the fitness center, we like to utilize the basement. This particular building is located in what's called the neighborhood shopping district, so changing the occupancy is a conditional use and we need ZBA approval. So we have the two gentlemen here from CrossFit. I submitted a floor plan for the new first floor in the basement. I believe Dave will go over the details of CrossFit in terms of their hours of operation, what's different about this particular fitness center compared to what you might see at a Boston Sports Club, what you might see at the other fitness centers, a little different style of fitness. So I'm going to pass it on to Dave and give you some details what we like to do. And just before I pass it on, I think what we had proposed the last time, since Dave was and his family were living at this particular location as an owner-occupied unit, we wanted to stay away from a restaurant. That was a request by his wife. Dave is trying to fulfill his obligation and find something other than a restaurant at this location and a fitness center. We think will be a good opportunity for all of us to get in shape.
Right, no excuses. Thank you, everybody. Congratulations to everybody who just won elections in your recent posts. Thanks for taking the time to listen to us. I'll just tell you a little bit about these guys from what I've known since I met them. They're local guys. They are going to operate this thing. Mike is going to be the primary partner here at the site. We'll be there every day. I'll obviously be there every day. We're excited for this use. We think as residents it would be a good use for the neighborhood. It's a class-based fitness program, different than machines, and I'll let these guys get into those kind of details. But if anybody has any questions about the building or what's going on over there today or in the future, I'll take those questions, obviously. And on the facade, one nice thing about this, other than that they're great guys and that I think it's a good use, is that the facade, we're going to be able to restore the old firehouse doors where the storefront used to be, so that their entrance would be on an old door opening that was closed up by Sheldon's a long time ago. So we'll be able to restore the old opening, make the front look a little bit more historic than it does today. So I'm excited about that, plus the use and the guys. So I'll let you guys talk about CrossFit.
Well, thanks for having us here today, guys. Very nice to meet you all. CrossFit is unique. I don't know, has anybody in here ever heard of CrossFit? Okay. Excellent. So you guys know a little bit about CrossFit. It is a group-based fitness training. It's more than circuit training. Generally, our training involves, it is 1 hour start to finish. Our classes are 1 hour start to finish. And we start our classes with a warm-up. We go into a strength/skill-based part of the workout in the middle, and then we finish with metabolic conditioning, okay? We use barbells, dumbbells, body weight, pull-ups, things such as that to complete our workout. It's a complete full body workout, and we don't repeat the same workouts over and over again as some people may do at a regular gym. If you go to Boston Sports Club, you'll mainly do isolation movements such as bicep curls, leg extensions, etc. We work the whole entire body instead of just isolation movements.
Some of the other things too is that, you know, with our training philosophy, your body is the machine. So we don't have treadmills, ellipticals, TVs, or other things that are picking up environmental energy sources. So we're providing the energy through our own bodies. Give you a little bit of background, this is going to be our second location. We presently have a location opening in Alston across from the Harvard Business School that has been open since 2005. We were the first CrossFit affiliate in all of the New England area, and we're expanding and trying to spread the word, so to speak, of a different level of fitness. And it's a comprehensive program where we work with people not just on the fitness side, but nutrition and just like a healthier lifestyle. So it's not, for us, it's not really just about a workout. It's much more than that.
You guys aren't affiliated with there's one in South Boston too, isn't there?
Yeah, so that's another thing.
It's franchised?
Not franchised. It's a licensed affiliation. So there's a licensing fee to use the name CrossFit. Okay. Each location is independently owned and operated.
Yeah, so, and then I'll speak a little bit on community aspect. So CrossFits are very community oriented, okay? All of our members know each other. It's a very community-based, that's what drives our business. If you look on the CrossFit website, one of the most important aspects of CrossFit is the community. So you said you noticed that Southie has one, the Fenway area has one, the Back Bay has one. And so the North End has a long time been a favorite of mine and Neil's. So we chose the North End as a spot where we would like to operate and do business. And the sport, CrossFit is called the sport of fitness. So that is something that we would like to bring to the North End. I would also like to talk about our clientele. Our clientele is, it's a very broad range of individuals. So it's men, it's women from 17 all the way up into 70s or however you know, it doesn't matter. There is no specific demographic that, you know, you don't have to fit a certain mold to come and do CrossFit. We have men and women that are in their 60s and 70s come and perform our movements, and you know, they want to stay fit and in shape, and so CrossFit is for anybody. We also recently launched a kids program, so we do a kids program for kids and preteens and teenagers as well. And that helps keep kids off the streets and involved in fitness and sports.
How many square feet, Dave?
Upstairs, there's 1,300 square feet, and then downstairs where the gym, or the locker room and the men's and ladies' showers are going to be, that is about another 1,000 feet. So there's 23 overall.
So you're going to use street level and then the basement?
Yep.
I just have one question. So it was last time you guys came, it was four residential and one retail?
Last time we were here, we changed it. It was strictly retail. We changed it to four residential.
Correct.
And the retail. So we are now
You went up a little too?
Went up one story. So we are now decreasing the residential units.
So where do you lose the residential?
On the first floor.
Is there a floor above?
No, on the first floor, there was the retail, and in the back of
the
retail,
okay,
we had a separate entrance with a one bedroom.
All right, thank you. I got confused when I saw that, so.
And we'll talk about hours of operation, deliveries,
yeah,
trash, which I think.
What's your hours of operation?
Yeah, Monday through Friday, the normal operation would be 6 a.m. start and ending around 8:30.
Okay.
Weekend would be a limited schedule, so we run with a skeleton schedule of like typically between 8 a.m. until about noonish.
And
yeah.
The trash removal?
I'm sorry?
The trash.
So,
sweat.
Yeah, sweat. One of the great things, we don't have a lot of trash, all right? But we would contract that out, obviously. Yeah.
And signage?
We haven't designed anything yet, but we anticipate some kind of a blade sign out over the sidewalk. that.
We want to be consistent with the North End appearance.
No neon, no.
Thank you.
Absolutely not.
We're very classic.
It's a building, so it'd be like an old world.
Right. I'm a resident of Beacon Hill, and so I definitely take pride in. Yeah, so this is one of our logos right here, which is the barbell with CrossFit Boston, and this is our main logo, which is the.
The signs you see every time you're going into, just reading that, like the state signs and district signs, and then where it would say, in the current logo, it says, you know, established 2005 for
right
CrossFit
here.
Boston, whereas for the new logo for the North End would have North End in there, 2012.
If you'd like, I can show you. I have a couple of sheets.
Toni has a question.
Yeah, I do. And Dave, this would, I'm sure you've already addressed this, noise, sound, proofing, vibration, loud music. It is very thickly settled there, and if you're starting at 6
yeah.
in the morning, that's, you know, I'm sure that you addressed
yeah.
the issue.
Yeah, so this was the one big concern when these guys came to us was, can we soundproof the space loud enough? So the first thing I did was I went to one of the classes, and after I could walk like a week later, I was sitting around thinking about soundproofing, and really what they do is they just have a home stereo system. It's like having a neighbor downstairs who turns his radio on at 8 a.m. They can always talk over the music. So it's not like the Southie one, if you've ever been there. They have a booming system. So we spent a lot of time discussing how loud the music would be, and then we're soundproofing between the units above and the two exterior walls. And we're pulled back from both the buildings on our left and our right. So we think we have enough space outside the building and what we're going to do inside the building to solve it.
If there are complaints, are you willing to modify the level or level of noise if the neighbors?
Yeah, Dave and I went through, and in the lease I specified, you know, like, look, this is what we currently have. We have tenants above us on the side of us. We have never had a complaint ever.
They say they haven't even ever heard our music.
Yeah. So we've never, and you know,
the Suffolk kids play louder than these guys.
I'm sure.
I mean,
I'm sure.
You know that.
I'm sure.
So
where are you located in Cambridge? What's the address?
It's 114 Western Ave. It's in the old WGBH building.
I know what it is.
Yeah.
So you say 114?
114, the rear of
yes.
the building.
One more question, in sure. class size, like, so there are they going to be like 30 people
no.
running through the door and then 30 people running out?
No, 15 would be max class size due to the size of the space. The biggest thing is that we want to make sure that when we're coaching, to kind of address the noise concern as well,
right.
is that we're coaching throughout the entire class, and if the music is too loud, we can't hear the coaching that's being done. So as loud as I want to be and I can be, it's not going to be effective if it's drowned out by music. So that's one of the things. We actually keep it down purposely a little bit. Music
yeah.
shouldn't be the driving force in your workout. And then as far as class size, you know, we want to make sure that people are getting individual attention within the group setting. So it's not like a group class setting where you come in and you just have an instructor in front doing the workout with you and you just follow along. We're, as instructors, we're walking around, we're correcting people's technique, cueing form, giving them instruction the entire time that they're in there. It's kind of, if anyone's ever done a personal training session, it's much more closer to that type of situation and environment than it is on just like a boot camp.
So, yeah, so I just would like to address a little bit more, like as Dave saw whenever he came and took the class, you know, the music definitely wasn't not turned up loud because, you know, you have to, like Neil said, you have to be able to interact with people and correct people on movement, and safety is of course one of our is our main concern. So we definitely, like, you know, we have to communicate so the music is not up that loud.
Yeah, and my wife is very noise sensitive, so
John,
we keep in line.
So we've had issues in the past in the neighborhood when, you know, it's not so much the issue with the business and the space of the business, but that they see their business as the neighborhood as well. So, for example, you know, you take things out on the street, and I know CrossFit does a lot of using, you know, the outdoor space that they have. I just wonder your plans with using the neighborhood as a business as well.
It's very difficult. I mean, obviously, Salem Street is going to be an area that we're not going to just be able to overflow out into the streets. That's not something we anticipate. So it's going to take a challenge of us of utilizing what space we do have and programming our workouts to be within the space. We're not going to be looking to occupy the north edge, so to speak.
Yeah. It's not, you know, some people do that, for example, you know, like in the Midwest and things like that. You know, they have a ton of space they can utilize. If you're in Manhattan, Boston, Washington, D.C., those places, you cannot do that. You know, it's just, it's a difference. You have to alter your programming, which is what we do. And we work within the means that we have.
Bill had a couple questions also.
How long is the lease on this?
10 years.
10-year lease? Tell me about deliveries. What sort of things will be delivered every day, and where will that delivery be done?
The only thing that would be delivered would be like water that we would sell, or something like a Vita Coco. Nothing. We'd never have any kind of semi trucks or anything like that coming through or anything.
So you're going to sell Gatorade and Vita Coco?
Vita Coco.
Yeah, not Gatorade.
And, you're not going to have like a juice bar, right? You're going to have a juice bar, you're going to sell, there's going to be no food, right?
The only thing would be like prepackaged, no vending machines or anything like that. It would just basically be like we would have a, at the desk, where if somebody wanted to purchase a post-workout bar.
Understood.
That type of thing.
And that'll be done at the desk?
Yeah.
How much do your classes cost?
So that would be something that,
for not then residents. I'm just kidding.
We don't want to talk.
For counseling.
So we like to do, so this, like Neil was saying earlier, this is very close to personal training. And if you've ever done personal training, you know that personal training is, no matter where you go in the city of Boston, starts at $100 an hour. And that's very run-of-the-mill Boston sports club. So we are closer to personal training, and if you get one-on-one coaching in every single class. Our classes, our memberships, start at $175 a month.
And you break it down based off the number of classes, it ends up being, in the ballpark, you're asking for a per class figure, can be roughly about $20 per class, you know, the average. Very similar to what people expect to spend when they go into a yoga studio and whatnot, but we do it on a monthly membership.
Members only, you can't walk in and take a class? Mm-hmm.
Correct.
Right.
Because so much of the movements are skill-based.
So we, for example, where I do yoga, it's $25 a session. And breaking it down on our memberships, it's about $18 a session versus personal training, which is $100 a session. So, I mean, the value is definitely there. That's why CrossFit is so popular, and you know, it works, and it's a great value for your money.
So you're going to sell a lot of water and a lot of...
Well, we'd probably put in like a Poland Spring where it had the line of water, so we wouldn't be selling a lot of water that way. If Vita Coco would be the main thing as far as refreshment. And then, you know, we have something that people call paleo kits. It's like grass-fed beef that's been dry, like jerky, and then with some mixed with fruits and nuts, very healthy type food.
You're gonna have recycling bins in the
we do recycle where we are right now. That's where we continue on with that. Recycling and trash bin.
Trash is a big issue in the neighborhood, but if you recycle, I think you guys know that there'll be less trash.
There'll be recycling in the building. We do have a hearing date, July 10th. Absolutely.
And you plan to stop construction when?
Well, the building is under construction now, so.
As soon as we get our permit.
So is the lease contingent on the actual zoning?
Yes.
Does anyone else have a question? Anyone out in the audience? Phil.
Would you take a part-time job as my bodyguard?
Anyone?
I like that answer.
Yeah, you need one. Just get a membership.
No questions?
Okay.
I have one more question.
So she has a question.
Go ahead.
Do Pilates?
Pilates. Oh, Pilates. No, we don't do Pilates classes.
So when so technically you're not done with the construction from the previous project,
right?
And when you're done with that, you'll then pull a permit to begin the CrossFit.
Yes.
What's your time? How
we're hoping the fall.
Fall?
Yeah.
You're hoping?
We're hoping.
Is everything going according?
Yeah, no, it's going according to plan. It's just going slow.
I know there's a lot. I know you're doing a lot of work.
We're not killing ourselves.
So you guys are hoping that by next spring you'll be ready to rock, or
before then?
No. We'll get them in the fall.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, they're going to get in.
So basically your build-out will be for them?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm doing everything. So,
I got you.
I've already talked to the inspector about doing a CO upstairs for... We'd like to get the family in before school starts the weekend. And
okay.
These guys right behind us
cool.
At the same time.
So. Awesome. Does anyone have a question? Going once. Anyone want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion to support 133 Salem Street, formerly Sheldon's Bargain Basement, David Crocini's application filed with the Zoning Board of Appeals for zoning relief to change the legal occupancy of the building from 4 residential units and a retail store to 3 residential units and a fitness center, which would be CrossFit North End. And of course, the renovation includes conversion of the basement.
Second.
So there's a motion on the floor,
John,
and there's a second. John, second the motion. All in favor? 10-0. Congratulations.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Baldwin Places, scratch.
Baldwin Places. Baldwin Places.
Jennifer Pretoria has applied to the licensing board for a wine and malt license. It's at 350-352 in Alma. Thanks for coming, Jay.
Good evening again, Dan Toscano, representing Jennifer Pretoria to my immediate right, who's the owner and occupier, the owner and operator of 350-352 Hanover Street, which would be a new business called the Tower. We were before the neighborhood last month in regards to changing the legal occupancy, and we were fortunate enough, thank you to the neighborhood, to get approval for changing the occupancy so we can add a restaurant at that location, with which would include takeout. And we had a petition, a request for a beer and wine license, and that matter was deferred due to the fact that we didn't officially file our application. We have recently filed our application for malt and wine only, no cordials, and we do have a hearing date for July the 11th. What is proposed, I think the for the newer board members, what is proposed is a gourmet pizza establishment. And when I say gourmet pizza establishment, it's not your traditional cheese pizza, pepperoni pizza. This is gonna be using the local markets, the seasoned ingredients, seasoned vegetables that's throughout the year, and changing the pizza rather than seeing your traditional pizzas. We will have 2 or 3 appetizers on the menu, maybe 2 hot appetizers, 3 cold appetizers on the menu. There's no dessert. This is a full sit-down service pizza establishment. We don't like to use the word pizza shop. It's not a pizza shop where you're going to be able to come in and grab a slice of pizza. No slices will be served at the location. However, full pizzas will be sold for for takeout purposes, but no slices will be sold. The hours of operation, we went over this the last time, however, for the application, it's 11 a.m. to 11 p.m. on Thursday to Sunday. Sunday through Thursday, and then on Fridays and Saturdays, 11 a.m. to midnight. And the reason why we're here for today for a beer and wine license is because we feel that this establishment would not survive without a beer and wine license. Who wouldn't want a glass of wine with their gourmet pizza, you know, made in the North End, or a glass of beer in the North End having some pizza? So that's why we feel that it's absolutely necessary that we try to seek getting approval for a beer and wine license. Given Jennifer Pretoria's background, working since 1992 this is the same concept that Jennifer and her husband Michael, sitting in the audience, operated on Prince Street.
You brought your own back one, okay?
Operated on Prince Street, which is now the new Mexican establishment. Jennifer and Michael had Mineo's Pizza. And Mineo's Pizza, which is we're going to mimic the same concept that they had back in 1992. Jennifer also and Michael were the original owners of Sage Restaurant at that location. They were at Sage Restaurant for a number of years, and then they owned and operated a business on Boylston Street called Bakari's. The reason why I tell you that is to tell you about Jennifer's experience working with beer and wine, working with an establishment that sells beer and wine, working with patrons that are drinking these beverages. So with that said, we're respectfully requesting your support for a beer and wine license to a responsible owner.
This is beer and wine only, right?
Beer and wine only, no cordials.
Anything else on the menu other than the gourmet pizzas?
There will be a few appetizers, maybe two hot appetizers, three cold appetizers, pizzas. I don't know if there's any
salad.
A few salads, but very limited menu. I think what I try to explain is the pizza establishment, it's not someone where someone's coming in, it's wait service only, it's no paper plates, no paper forks and knives, silverware, fine china, wait service, sit down. There's going to be approximately 18 patrons, 9 tables, seating capacity for 18.
I know you went over this last month, but what are the hours again?
The hours of operation were Sunday to Thursday, 11 a.m. to 11 p.m., and on Friday and Saturday, 11 a.m. to midnight.
They came last month, if anyone wasn't here, for zoning change.
And last month, and I know the members, we did have a good group of support of abutters. I sent out public notice to the general abutters. However, I have not received any opposition to the petition.
There's no bar here at all?
No bar, just seating for 18 and 19.
Forgive my ignorance if this is a separate license or not even allowed at all, but if you're providing takeout pizza, can I also grab a takeout six-pack?
No, we're not selling six-packs. We're not selling case of beer. It's not going to be a refrigeration for beer to come in. No, it's not a package.
It's not a retail license. It's a service license.
Yeah, it's a restaurant license.
Will there be any pitchers?
No.
Glass and cut? Glass and bottles?
Glass and bottles, yeah.
No draft. I mean, obviously you're not going to have a bottle, so you don't.
No draft.
And a pizza to go? To go?
Full pizzas, no slice.
Full slices?
Only for you, Stephen. I'm right across the street.
Any other questions? I know it's probably kind of redundant. They were here last month. They were approved to change the zoning to...
zoning was changed from two residential apartments, a barbershop and a store, to two residential apartments, barbershop and restaurant. We did have a hearing with the ZBA back on June the 5th, and we got full support from the board.
Anyone?
What's the name of the restaurant?
Locale.
L-O-C-A-L-E.
Any abutters here? Does anyone have any questions?
I know, Stephen, that the supporters did say, even though this technically wasn't on the agenda, that they were in favor of it, if they weren't able to attend tonight. I know that was something that Don recognized.
Anyone want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion to support 350-352 Hanover Street, which is formerly Hamlet Hanover News, to Jennifer Vittori for a beer and malt license at this location.
So I have a motion to support a wine and malt license at 352 Hanover Street. Anyone second the motion?
Can I second the motion?
Motion's been seconded. All in favor?
I hope that's the Red Sox score tonight. I know.
Mr. President, members of the board, once again, thank you for your time. Thank you.
Thank you.
One more item on the agenda.
I can pass it on.
George Mendoza, who's on our board, is obviously related to Frankie and Patrick, so he will be recusing himself from this meeting. They have applied, Monica's has applied to the licensing board to add cordials to the existing malt and wine license. And they are also asking the licensing board to change their hours of operation, closing at 11 on Monday through Thursday and a midnight closing on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Is that correct, Billy?
That's correct, but that's open to interpretation. Simply meaning the request is for weekend midnight closing in keeping with the neighbor policy, but I don't know, we're sure what weekend nights are. It's put in as Friday, Saturday, Sunday, if that's still considered to be the weekend nights. Interpretation being, is it Friday and Saturday, or is it Friday, Saturday, and Sunday? So I'm never sure myself.
Billy, it's Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, if that's what you're asking for. I mean,
we'll yes, that's what it's in for, with my understanding that is the so-called acceptable community good neighbor policy. But we'll explain that if you want.
Go ahead, brother.
Well, good evening. My name is Bill Ferrullo, and as everyone else has said, welcome and congratulations to the new members and new officers to come. You may know the gentleman to my right, Pat and Frank Mendoza, who not only are restaurant operators, but are residents of Bogota and raising their families here, and have operated Tateria de Monica at 67 Prince since 1995, 17 years. It is the first of the restaurants that the Mendoza family has operated in the neighborhood. I think you may know the other fellow who's involved in this, who moved the seat, George, who operates the Vinoteca on Richmond Street. The restaurant of Prince, as you see from the menu, is a small trattoria-style restaurant that has had beer and wine service with an 11 p.m. closing hour while it's been there. The request is simply to add cordial service because they do serve coffee and dessert, and they're finding not only is it requested by patrons, but naturally it would help the restaurant to avail themselves of people staying longer, especially on slower weekday nights, winter nights, etc., to have a dessert and have a cordial coffee, etc. The additional hour on the weekend, once again, is the same. It's just that weekends tend to be busier, and the extra hour actually is good for the business to be able to have the ability to stay open till midnight as opposed to just 11 o'clock the way they have. Needless to say, like any other restaurants, on slow winter nights, you know, 11 o'clock closing sometimes means 9 o'clock to 10 o'clock, depending on, you know, what foot traffic is. But once again, these gentlemen are at the restaurant every day and every night. They're running across the street to the little grocery shop that they also operate in the neighborhood. Just about everyone probably knows them or frequents their businesses. They're excellently run. It's an addition to the neighborhood that you will not hear a bad word about. So the purpose is to serve the clientele, but also to help the business in the slower periods. Everyone thinks of the not them as being Friday and Saturday night every week, but you do have 7 nights that you have to pay staff and keep people employed and keep the restaurant open. So that's the purpose of the request. Nothing changes about the service. If you've been in, you know how small it is. There's no bar area, so they're not mixing drinks. It's just to serve that cordial, if in fact you want dessert and coffee. So.
That's it?
That's about it.
Yeah, that's it.
Pat and Frank are here.
Anyone have any questions on the council about anything? Is this great? Go ahead, John.
Well, no, I mean, I personally see these as two separate items. I see one of them a request to extend the hours and the other about the adding cordials.
Yeah, we put it together only because Pat and Frank have been thinking about changing those hours only because it just never filed. You know, if it was filed as an 11 o'clock closing, you know, back in 95, and it's never changed. And now with the thought process that they were going to do the cordials, the idea was to combine the two things at the same time.
What we decided to do is we'll vote on to add the cordials as one vote, and then we'll vote on to the hours, all right?
And as we're saying, we leave it to the body as to what the weekend is, Friday and Saturday, or Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
I get you.
Well, on that point, though, what are you asking for?
Well, the request went in as Friday, Saturday, Sunday, because we quite honestly don't. No one has a good answer about what people
consider. So we can vote on Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Right. And as we say, we're amenable to whatever policy is, if people know what policy is.
I don't think there is one.
If people say policy is Friday, Saturday, Sunday, that's our request. If it's Friday and Saturday, that's our request. Okay. We'll amend, you know, at the board if it turns out it's Friday and Saturday.
Sure, Stephanie.
Well, maybe a clarification. And my congratulations to all the re-elected and newly elected members of the council. I'm Stephanie Hogue. I'm a resident on Hinchman Street, and I'm also currently the president of the Residents Association. So I can clarify what our policy is, and you're very close here. Our policy is Sunday through Thursday, 11 p.m., and Friday and Saturday, midnight. So I'm sure that we'll be seeing this at our ZLC committee.
And I'm saying, not to address it as a NORA issue, but we want to be simply consistent with policy. If I did put it in as Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and it turned out that people said it was Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, you're not able to amend it the other way. I am able to amend it going down, but not going up.
Well, if I can just speak for 1 second, I apologize. You want to say something?
No, I was just saying, what does everybody else consider?
We've seen a variety.
I've been on the council going on 6 years, and I remember having a vote on multiple issues about licenses, one being how many licenses, pouring licenses, whether they were all alcohol, beer and wine, and how many of those we were going to cap. And we voted, I think when Aaron was president actually, and I think we voted to, in accordance with how many beer and wine, or how many pouring licenses we'd have, and I think if the number was 92 or whatever it was. The reality of my, this is just my opinion, and you guys can have your opinions obviously, but there is no policy on capping beer and wines to the city. The licensing board does not have a cap on the north end, and the licensing board also does not have a policy on Sunday through Thursday. So they will base their decision on what we recommend, or what NORA and we recommend. So there has been a lot of turnover since the first time I got on this council until now. And I'm sure if we took a vote now, it'd be different, and it would probably be different 5 years from now. That's why I don't like to go down the road and debate on, is it Thursday through Sunday? Is it Friday and Saturday only? Is it 91? Is it 92? Is it all alk? Is it beer and wine? How many cordials? I think that we base each application on its merits, and then we make a decision. And if the chairman of the licensing board and the chairman of the and chairwoman of the licensing board decide that they want to give them Monday through Thursday 11, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday 12, then that's what the licensing board does. I mean, it's up to us, but I just think it's an open-ended question. We can sit here and talk about it all night long, but that's just my opinion. I know NORA has a policy, but they have a policy in writing. They have a good neighbor agreement, all that stuff. That stuff, that's just been one of those debates that we never seem to get to the bottom of.
Steve, it's always a point of law that you have to vote on one way or the other.
I know that, yes. But I'm just making a point that we don't technically have a good neighbor. I understand. So if you want to vote, if you want us to vote on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, then, I mean, that's someone wants to make a motion
and
to
again,
amend it.
I understand what we're saying. Our application is to conform to what the neighborhood believes to be a good neighbor policy. Now, again, since that's open to interpretation, it's a moving target for us. Meaning, if the interpretation is it's Friday and Saturday night,
I know exactly what you're saying.
We respect that, and we would accept Friday and Saturday night. I can't file two applications for the same thing because people...
No, that's fine. We understand that piece, but I'm just... The whole closing hour, Thursday, Friday,
it's like a Venn diagram down here. You can never, we never get to the bottom of it. And I know the neighborhood council has it on the, as I've been here, I know NEWRA has, they're a little stricter. And Stephanie, if you want to speak again, go ahead,
please. I just want to say that the members of NEWRA who have been voting over the years have been pretty consistent over the last few years about really wanting that 11 on Sunday and accepting the midnight on Friday and Saturday. So I would say that the residents who do care to come out have been consistent in what they want. And I would put that to the members of the council for your consideration.
I'd like to suggest that we just keep it as Saturday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, because oftentimes a weekend is three nights if there's no work on Monday. And they're not going to get people on a Sunday at 12 o'clock if they have to work on Monday. Mm-hmm. So on the rare occasions where it's a three-day weekend, let's just leave it the way it is.
I mean, my I love when this question comes up because we can sit here till tomorrow morning. But you know, my opinion on all these licensing questions has always been based on the applicant. And I tell you what, it was. This agenda tonight was great. You know, you had Dave Percini in here with guys from FitCore. There's a guy who lives in the neighborhood, going to live in the building.
CrossFit.
You know, CrossFit, excuse me, FitCore. It's embarrassing. I'm sorry. you know, Jen and Michael are here. They're going to open up a business, local family. Their kids go to school in the neighborhood. Dave's kids go to school in the neighborhood. The Mendozas exemplify everything the neighborhood is. The whole family's here, father, brothers, sisters. I mean, the kids, they own buildings. I mean,
yes.
I just, my opinion is always.
She has an apartment.
My thought process
is
always.
She owns the building on Stillman Street, and she owns the business too. And she's our sister.
And she has an apartment on Stillman.
My thought process is always to.
We're a huge family. We're all family oriented. We have tons of kids. We live in the neighborhood. We live in the building. We love the North End.
We film the early in school.
Huh? Yeah, we love the North End. We are the North End. We love it.
I mean, bottom line is sure. Bottom line is we. I like to support family owned, operated businesses. I think that's what a neighborhood is, and I don't think we have enough of it here. So, you know, when I see local people owning local businesses, it reminds me of when I was a kid, everyone who owned a business was a local person who lived upstairs, had a store downstairs. Mm-hmm. I think we should get back to more of that. I mean, you're talking about people in this room that are accessible. If there's a problem, they're not hard to find. Dave isn't hard to find anymore. Jen and Michael aren't hard to find. They are accessible neighbors that just happen to own a business and just happen to want to stay open another extra hour. I mean, if... you know, you can have a different opinion. I'm just saying that's the way I look at it. That makes I think the neighborhood fit in good.
I great neighbors. They have bought our building. As you know, we've never had a problem. They clean up. Even their workers are very cordial. Just all around great guys.
And that's a direct spot.
Yeah, just to reinforce what everybody's saying, I mean, these guys could rightly do neighbor policy because they're great neighbors.
Anyone? I'm sorry.
I'll agree.
That's a rare one.
I don't live in the North End, but my kids do go to school here. But I've been going to Monica since they opened, and then again on Richmond Street when they opened that. It's their direction favorite restaurants in the North End. They've just been nothing but, as you know, vendors, nothing but, you know, great hosts.
Does anyone else have any questions?
We agree.
I'll throw bouquets at them all night.
Didn't you throw enough?
They're good guys, man. It's bottom line.
They're also responsible for raising $20,000 a year to support the other school.
Yeah, they should have went for 2 a.m. with all this goodwill.
Does anyone want to motion?
I'll make a motion to support 67 Prince Street, Monica's for...
So why don't we motion on the cordials first? If anyone wants to motion on adding the cordials to the beer, malt and wine.
Okay.
So go ahead.
I'll do the hours.
Do whatever you want.
Let me do the hours.
Sure.
Okay. To add the existing, the hours from Sunday to Thursday, 11 o'clock, and from Friday, from Monday to Thursday, 11 o'clock, and from Friday to Sunday, 12 o'clock.
Okay, so there's a motion on the floor to support changing the hours of operation at 67 Prince Street, Monica's Mercato. Is that right, Monica's Trattoria?
That's the corporate thing.
Okay, Monica's Mercato Inc. So the Trattoria at 67 Prince from
Monday
through Thursday will be 11 p.m. closing, and Friday, Saturday, and Sunday will be closing at midnight. Anyone second?
Second.
So there's a motion. It was seconded. All in favor? Is that 10?
Who seconded?
So it can't be 10 to 11.
10
to
9.
I know.
I can't see, so it's okay. Thank you, buddy. So the hours of operation have been supported, and if anyone wants the motion to support adding cordials to the existing malt and wine, please do so.
I'll motion, Steve.
Okay.
Motion to add cordials to existing malt and wine license.
So there's a motion to add cordials to the existing malt and wine license at 67 Prince Street, Monica's Mercato Inc.
And AKA I'll second that.
And a second of the motion. All in favor? 9-0 again? I'm not even looking. You're all set. 9-0, 9-0.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Dan Toscano wants the record to show that he was able to get 10 to 0.
And you had to go last on the agenda. Are there any anyone else here to want to discuss any other neighborhood issues? I know we have a open discussion kind of period.
I do have an issue that I wanted to start a discussion on.
Sure.
We don't have to finish it tonight, but I was glad to see that we didn't have any zoning applications tonight for converting a retail space to a restaurant.
Okay.
Because I wouldn't have wanted to say anything while a license was under consideration, because I think this is something that we all need to think about. The residents need to think about, the business owners need to think about, the residents association and the council needs to think about. I heard a lot of discussion, and I know Phil mentioned it in the regional, that we've had conversion of retail space now and people looking for restaurants. I think over the years that I've been involved in the neighborhood, there have been a lot of zoning variances granted to change retail to restaurant. We've also seen applications for people to convert first floor retail to living space. And I've noticed over this past year, we've had a couple of prominent business owners come in and talk about what they need to help pay the rent. And I also hear anecdotally throughout the neighborhood, non-restaurant business owners talking about the expense of the rent. I think we've been, in effect, rezoning the neighborhood by the issuance of variance, which means we're not really talking about what do we want to see in our neighborhood. How much more expansion of restaurants do we want, and how does it impact the non-restaurant business community? And I'm just throwing this out here and saying this is a discussion that I think the neighborhood needs to start to have.
Well, you have to keep in mind, though, that in a day and era where stores are closing down on Washington Street,
mm-hmm.
Big stores like Marlene's are gone.
Yeah.
Stores are closing down in Firehall.
Yeah.
Crate and Barrel, William Sonoma, where the internet is where everybody's buying their goods at a very low premium because people are playing for retail spaces. There's an issue with what type of businesses you'd like the community to have. The only issue is, can those businesses afford to be in the community, and would the community support those businesses? Will you buy your shoes, for example, at Naha Shoes? Not any longer, because nobody bought the shoes at Naha Shoes. And that's the problem he had. So, and I talked to him, for example, and he said that most people are getting their shoes on the internet, because it's much cheaper. So those are issues that, unfortunately, are not just not just taking place in the North End. They're taking place throughout the nation.
Yeah.
The culture of shopping. If you could buy your dinner on the internet, I bet you money we'll all be in trouble. That own restaurants, you know what I mean. So that's the reality of it. The reality is that the change on the occupancy of storefronts is, first of all, it's very difficult to operate a storefront in the North End. Mm-hmm. We own one, but we own the property. We bought the property. Okay? It was extremely expensive to keep on renting, and we bought the property, and that's the reason why we can afford to have a grocery store. But if I told you how much rent we pay to our company to pay the mortgage for that piece of property, it carries most of the building, just a little store. So that's the issue.
That's one of the points I'm trying to make is I think we've set an expectation now that if a building owner that's got a retail space applies for a variance to have a restaurant or to have a living space instead, they're likely going to get it. And we're not really paying attention with how the area is zoned. And maybe what we need to talk about is how do we want it zoned? What do we want in the neighborhood, and what are we willing to support?
I know we had this conversation. Remember, you and I had this conversation. We talked at length about this, and I said exactly what George just said. You know, I know people who pay north of $10,000 a month for their space on Hanover Street, mm-hmm. and you know, when you have a property owner who owns a building, mm-hmm. and maybe doesn't want a restaurant in their building, it's extremely difficult for them to get market value for that retail space without it being up. Now, with that said, that's Hanover Street. I think we need to be careful with retail space and with all that other commercial space in and around, you know, maybe like a street like North Bennett Street or Hull Street or Pachata.
But that's more what I'm thinking of.
Maybe I can help through City Council's office. Maybe what we need to do is have the BRA look at rezoning the neighborhood and maybe defining, you know, areas where that, you know, the shopping sub-districts and all that other stuff. And what's a conditional use and what's a forbidden use on certain streets.
Steven, a good way to keep rents affordable is for the mayor to stop raising taxes.
Owning
a building in the North End is a very expensive enterprise. So you need to understand, we don't live in a cheap city. We live in a very expensive city, a beautiful city.
I mean,
but our taxes have gone up in the last 2 years to the maximum they could go up in a year, and he keeps on raising them. So if you realize what the cost of owning property in the North End is, one of the costs involved in any piece of property, you're talking about $12,000 to $15,000 a year in taxes for a four-unit building, divide that up. That's why the rents are so expensive. The other thing, too, is that I would love to question, are we going to start, you know, deciding what goes where and
that's the problem.
What a landlord, the lord who owns the land, can do with his land? I mean, that's a really, deciding to our liking what should be and what should not be, where we decide what should go where. I mean, usually it's public need. The reason why the stores are not working out in the North End is because there is no public need for certain things. I mean, certain things are very costly in the North End. If you're going to buy and shop for your clothing in a boutique in the North End, you're going to find out that clothes are very expensive in the boutiques in the North End because of the cost of operating in Boston. It's the same thing in Boston in general. It's just not the North End. If you go to Boston Street, and you went to Boston Street 20 years ago, there was plenty of stores. You go to Boston Street today, there's a lot of restaurants. You go to shopping malls today, there's a lot of restaurants.
I mean, look at the spot that Nikki's gonna occupy. So Casa di Style, whatever it's called, the place has been empty for a while. Yeah. I mean, I'd rather see him in there selling pizza. And honestly, Jen, I'd rather see her selling pizza than having a chemo parlor.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I think
they fit the location. You know, I mean, are we going to put her? I mean, but like George said, that's very true. You know, you start rezoning, then you start basically telling people what they can and can't have, and I have to agree.
Back when we were a community that wasn't so much of a tourist attraction, we had...
Okay, well, the idea of zoning is that you do, as a community, sit down and think about what you want where. That's the idea.
We're zoned now. I mean...
Well, we're zoned, but I think we've been rezoning by just issuing variances, which is certainly not a plan.
I've worried about this myself. I think we're going to restaurant ourselves out of the appeal that we've had for people. I think people come here for Polcari's, they come here for the Asylum. They come here for mics and modern. They come here for a variety of experiences, not just to go into a restaurant and come out of it and go someplace else. They like to mingle. They like to see things in the neighborhood. And if they're all restaurant fronts, I think at some point the market will drive that. We will become restaurant oversaturated, and then we will lose that variety and that appeal. I think the restaurants could actually endanger their own economy in this neighborhood if we become restaurants only or almost only. So I think the variety is very important, but I also agree, and I agree with George that and Stephen, that we can't be telling people how much money they're able to derive out of their investment, and that's just not the way we operate. I think we're zoned, and they're working, and zoning allows variances. That's what it's called, a zoning variance.
It allows variances for very specific reasons. There are like maybe four reasons for a variance.
I mean,
that
I worry
are given
about the problem,
zoning,
but I'm not sure we can
talk about
dictate
that.
How to solve it by denying variances when variances are legal.
You know what I would suggest? I would suggest that we all support local businesses, and we stop going to Stop and Shop, and to let's all shop in the North End.
Yeah, that's a great.
Let's buy a bread here. Let's buy things here. One of the issues that I see as a business owner is that I see very few North End people. You know, the percentages of people who are consuming goods in the North End, who are from the North End, it's a very small number. It's 10%, 5% of your clientele. If I do 1,000 people a week, you know, we are a neighborhood-driven company, so we do get a lot of regulars back, but the percentage of, let me put it this way, let me give you a perfect example. For the restaurant industry, so we're talking about the restaurant industry, when the winter months come and traffic flow to the North End of visitors slows down, we all see a numbers drop. It's the quietest season of the year. We do get our core, which is, you know, the percentage of people that are coming in that are community-based business for us. But there's a very large amount of the people that we are seeing are the people that are coming to the North End. Well, then the question needs to be asked. You know, we are one of the most famous Italian neighborhoods in the country. What are Italians famous for? Unfortunately, for the ones of us that don't like restaurants, they are famous for their food. So what are the businesses that are still thriving in the North End? The good bakeries, the good grocers, the Polcaris's, the coffee shops, the restaurants. Reason being, one of the most important parts of the Italian culture is food. And as a good community, as a good Italian community, we have a lot of food. Back in the day, when I first arrived here in 1984, we had a lot of Italian grocers. We had the butcher, we had the fishmonger, we had the this, we had the that. And when you went there, I went with my mother's list to go and purchase my cutlets or the fish or whatever. We used to go to Jufri's on Cross Street. You would only see the likes of me and some of the older folks who are still doing their grocery shopping here. But again, those grocers have big competition outside of the neighborhood, which are the Stop and Shop back in the day on Charles Street, the Johnny's Food Master. You know, the issue is not that as a community we don't want those to see little stores everywhere. The issue is that we're not using those little stores. That's why the little stores, you know, unfortunately the small operator decides, you know what, my kid doesn't want to be a butcher. So what am I going to do here? You know, I mean, that might happen to Susie's meat market on Sound Street. You know, we're fortunate to have a fish market again, to whom I go there all the time. I get my sushi there for lunch and I get fish for the family. Nevertheless, sometimes you go in there and you're the only person there, you know? So I would say, how do we promote, you know, how do we become advocates for, hey guys, shop within our community, help our neighbors out. You know, you're gonna go out for dinner, come out for dinner over here, but you're gonna go for groceries, go to Sialva for your tomatoes, you know, go, you know, where people are not doing that. The other aspect of it is that demographics can change, how many people cook at home, you know, so that's a reality, you know, and I can't buy my jeans at Ingenious, those cuts don't fit me, you know, I still.
No, let's not talk about size, very touchy subject.
One other point, though, with the Dave's example of turning a residential unit into commercial space, which is usually not so typical, but totally necessary in this neighborhood for us to have a fitness center, totally necessary. And if we predetermine what is zoned for commercial and what's zoned for residential, and we're not flexible on an individual basis, we're going to get ourselves in trouble, because, you know, that's a perfect example of one small one-bedroom apartment, now fitness center.
I understand what you're saying, and I'm not saying that there wouldn't be instances where we should support a variance. What I think is happening in the neighborhood is we're not even attempting to do any kind of planning.
Well,
and that is impacting the residential quality of life in the neighborhood.
I do think, though, that I don't know how your panel works, but our panel, each one of us represents a little pocket of the community. I'm on Endicott Street. I know what the people from my area need, and we try to promote that. You know, I mean, we, you know, we have an ice cream shop on Endicott Street. I hope somebody buys their ice cream, because ice cream spoils and expires, you know? So, you know, I mean, I think that the format that we have here, we do, all of us represent a little portion of the community. You know, we represent a little demographic of the community. I don't think that by our actions, we are actually telling the community we're not doing your work. Unfortunately, you know, people are not coming over to open grocery stores, you know, and they're not coming over to open button shops and textile places like we used to have. You know, things have changed and needs have changed. I gotta tell you something, I don't even remember when was the last time I didn't buy my clothes from the internet. I'm not that well dressed, but I do shop on the internet. I mean, my sporting equipment, I buy it on the internet. My, you know, we used to have a sporting goods store on Hanover Street next to Roma Flower Shop, remember? Yeah.
Sports Magic.
Yeah, they closed down. Nobody bought their shoes there. So those are the issues. We don't want to be painted as the people that are not, that are trying to change the demographics of the community to have just restaurants, you know? That's not the case. The unfortunate thing is that we do have retail spaces and nobody else is filling them. And, you know, we do have a vibrant community. We have a safe community. You know, we have people coming in and enjoying it, you know. And I think that restaurants are going to be to a certain point. You know, one day that level is going to overflow, and then things are going to go in a different direction.
Thanks, Sosta.
Thank you.
Adjourned?
Yeah, meeting adjourned. Unless anyone else.